Throws are empty for a reason. It is New Year's Eve. That means it's time to brush up on those bubbly basics. So we've asked Peter Smolarz, fine wine director at Willow Park Wines and Spirits, to give us a refresher in champagne and sparkling wine 101. Welcome back to the show.
Thanks for having me again.
You were saying these, everything is flying off the shelves right now. Everything with bubbles.
Super fast.
Okay, so I think the biggest question for people is champagne versus sparkling. So tell us the fundamental differences, I suppose.
Very, very common question. The biggest thing is champagne comes from a place.
Right.
So champagne is a sparkling wine. It comes from northern France, from the appellation of Champagne.
Right.
This is around the towns of Reims and Epernay. These wines themselves, they're really regulated, the laws from where the grapes can come from, but more importantly, the procedure to make this wine. So these wines themselves have great backbone of acidity, these many, many tiny champagne bubbles, and more importantly, this depth of flavor that reaches into a rich brioche, bready flavor.
Yeah.
Compared to other sparkling wines, you can mimic this procedure, but you can't mimic the style and that quality of grapes that you get from the Champagne region.
Okay, so anything that actually has the word champagne on it will come from the Champagne region and will have a certain measure of quality?
That level of standard of quality for champagne to carry that on the label must be met before they give you the word champagne.
Okay, so but that doesn't mean that there aren't fantastic sparkling wines from other places, right?
No, there are many, many mimics of champagne. Yeah, so you can, if you look at a wine label, you can read it like a map. So if you're looking at something like this, it'll say Cava. Cava is one of my favorites. This is a Spanish sparkling wine that's made just like champagne, but with local grape varieties. So really, really good value. Here you'll also see a term called Cape Classique. Method Cape Classique, again, made exactly like champagne, even the same grapes, but coming from South Africa's Western Cape. So here you can find the style that you're looking for, but in much better value.
And okay, so like a cava like this versus champagne. So what does champagne run you generally?
Champagne's gonna start at $40 bare minimum.
Right.
You can work your way sky high from there, depending on what you're looking for. Where a cava, you can get in $10 range, all the way up to 20. These Cape Classiques or Cremants from France, you can get in that 20 to 30 zone. So really good value. They don't have the finesse of the bubbles or that depth of flavor, but they do give you a very, very close substitute.
Okay, and Prosecco, people reach for that quite often. So what are the qualities of Prosecco generally?
So Prosecco has changed a lot over the last few years. It's actually a region as well, but in northern Italy. In this case, the bubbles are much lighter. It's very airy. This is fresh and fruity. We don't get any of those bready notes. This is something that is, if you're thinking about a crowd pleaser, is going to work for you every time.
Right.
Very bright, very fresh. You want to throw some juice or liqueur in there. It's a great cocktail option.
You don't feel like you're wasting anything, too, because the price point is good. So
well, exactly. In the 10 to 20 zone, you get yourself something that's quite nice. And on the end there, you see something called an Asti. And an Asti is going to let us know that this is a light alcohol, sweet sparkling.
Right.
So you could also use this again if you just want to have something sparkling, but you don't want to have that full alcohol, so it's just something quite light, quite easy.
Okay, so let's move back over to the Champagne region here. So tell us about this particular champagne that you've brought in.
So we have two different ones. We have the Piper Heitzig. This is a non-vintage Brut. This is going to be very similar to what you find normally. Brut on a label just lets us know that this is a dry style wine.
Okay.
Next to it, we have Tattenjay. This is Tattenjay's Nocturne, beautiful
That's
bottle.
So pretty.
They won an award for this. We call it the disco bottle.
Yeah.
And this is actually stated as a sec. And what a sec is just a slightly sweet. And then from there, you'll also see demi-sec, which is even sweeter than that.
Okay.
So you can have champagnes that aren't bone dry. So if you're not used to drinking champagne, you can do something a little softer, like the Tattenjay.
Okay, let's talk about serving it. So glassware, people ask for a champagne flute. There is a reason, right?
Exactly. So very important. You know, many, many years ago, we used the little saucer.
Right.
Okay, that is not going to work for us. And then after years, we got into the straight flute. Now we have Riedel's Cuvée Prestige glass. This is my preferred glass because of the little bulby part at the bottom. If you think about the grapes that go into sparkling wine, they like to be trapped for the aromatics.
Mm.
So we use this flute style so we can see the bubbles go up. These glasses themselves have an etch at the bottom, so you can really get a good line of those tiny great champagne bubbles, but also allow you to nose the wine, which is half the palate itself.
I think we're going to keep you here for a little while longer because we're going to talk about service temperature and also, well, we should open one.
Yeah,
we should watch you open one.
It's midnight somewhere.
Properly, I think, right? Yes, it is. It's already happening in Australia and New Zealand. Okay.